Amazon intros a new Kindle, an Imagine Cup finalist is chosen, and a robotic mower saves you some work. All that news and more on this week's World Tech Update. Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. We'll get to our top news in just a second, but wanted to let you know that World Tech Update now has a Facebook fan page. So if you want to find out what's coming up on each week's show in more than 140 characters, go check us out. Topping our news this week is the unveiling of Amazon's Kindle DX, which has a larger screen than the Kindle 2, something the company hopes will make newspapers and magazine content easier to read.
Kindle DX provides a 9.7-inch display. It's a nice big display. It's about 2.5 times the size of the Kindle we announced 3 months ago. What that allows customers to do is read highly formatted content, whether that's books like cookbooks, travel books, computer books, textbooks, or documents that you use for work or at home, personal and professional documents.
The new device also has more storage than either of its predecessors. The Kindle DX can store 3,500 books, more than double of what the Kindle 2 can. Like the Kindle 2, the DX also has 3G wireless capability. The Kindle DX costs $489 and is available for pre-order now. It will ship in the third quarter. Microsoft held the U.S. finals of the Imagine Cup this week. The competition challenges high school and university students to address the United Nations Millennium Goals, which include ending poverty and hunger, providing universal education, and combating AIDS, among other topics. This week in Cambridge, the top 15 teams in the U.S. showed off their projects, and one was chosen to represent the country at the worldwide finals in Cairo. That team developed MultiPoint, software that lets multiple users play a game on a single computer.
In short, what it is, it's a set of mini-games, educational mini-games, that allow multiple children to use one computer at the same time. It is also web-based, and the advantage of it being web-based is you don't have to install anything. If you can browse a website, you can play these games. How it works is it's built on Silverlight. That allows it to be web-based and allow us to do any type of game we can think of. We can just build it right there. The multi-point part that allows multiple mice wraps the multi-point SDK that Microsoft already has out there, but that doesn't support any web or Silverlight. So we wrap that in ActiveX, and it communicates through JavaScript directly to our Silverlight.
The games themselves are aimed at elementary school students and are somewhat basic, but the team hopes that once the software gains traction, that students and teachers will develop more content for it that they can share with other users. Staying with Microsoft news, the company's Windows 7 release candidate is now available to the public.
It means that we're entering that final phase of testing for Windows 7, the next release of the Windows operating system.
Some of the new additions on the release include remote media streaming, which Microsoft says enables highly secure remote internet access to digital files stored on a home PC. The new version of Windows also includes touch control, and by using touch-enabled screens, users can drag, drop, and select items. While the official release candidate became available to the public on May 5th, the OS had already shown up in force on a number of BitTorrent tracking sites. Windows 7 has repeatedly leaked to file sharing sites since previews were first handed out in October 2008 at Microsoft's Professional Developers Conference, with no apparent reaction from the company. Microsoft CEO Steve Ballmer spoke to a hall of PAX students at Stanford on Wednesday. His message was that despite the downturn in the economy and even 3,000 layoffs at Microsoft this week, he doesn't think the contraction will be strong enough to prevent big ideas from getting funding. Ballmer even touched on Yahoo, saying that there may or may not be appropriate discussions, but that's all he would reveal. In fact, Ballmer may not have been in Silicon Valley only to visit Stanford. The Wall Street Journal blog, All Things D, citing unnamed sources, said he also plans a meeting with Yahoo CEO Carol Bartz. For those couch potatoes out there, check out this robotic lawnmower from Stockholm-based Husqvarna. The Automower 260 ACX can navigate and cut up to 6,000 square meters, or about an acre and a half, all on its own. It can even keep its owner updated on progress or problems.
We embedded a GSM module in the product, and the product uses this module to send you a text message if it needs assistance and to let you know what's going on.
The auto mower is powered by two nickel metal hydride batteries and can cut for about an hour on a single charge. That equates to about 250 square meters or 2,700 square feet of cut lawn. When it's low on batteries, it returns to its base station and charges for 40 minutes. An ultrasonic sensor helps the mower avoid obstacles. It sells for about 4,000 euro or about 5,300 US dollars. Imagine snapping together a computer like Legos. That's the idea behind the Bug, which was on hand at the Soul of the New Machine this week, a conference covering technology and how it's being used by human rights groups. The base of the Bug system is a Linux computer with an MX processor and 120 megabytes of RAM. From there, a user can add on different hardware modules.
If I'd like to then plug in a module, we have a whole collection of modules. We have everything from an audio to a camera to GPS to motion detector accelerometers to Zigbee. I can build things just by snapping together. So in this case, maybe I want to take a picture of something, so I can take my camera module. I plug in my camera module, and now I can use it to take pictures. I can plug in a GPS module, and now I'll have a camera that I can take pictures with that will geotag, right? Maybe what I really like to do is take pictures and send them to the internet, so now I can plug in my, this is a 3G GSM data modem, so I can now put this on a network.
The Bug base and four hardware modules cost 600 US dollars. Japan might be well known for sumo wrestling, but it was fighting of a different kind that had Tokyo's Akihabara excited this week. At the Kondo battle, robots from across the country came to fight and win bragging rights. The robots doing battle were all made by individuals or small teams of hobbyists, and each came with its own special fighting technique that was the inspiration of its creator. Competition was sometimes fierce, sometimes rough, and sometimes as simple as keeping upright while a competitor flailed around, trying to stand up before being counted out. At least one robot ended its competition injured. A wayward cable came unplugged here and instantly ended its chances of progressing further. The event was sponsored by Kondo Kagaku, which sells kits and parts that allow people to build their own robots. And that's our show. Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. Be sure to tune in next week for your weekly bite of all the major tech news. As we head out, we'll leave you with some more footage of the battling robots. And don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. I'm Nick Barber, and for all of us here at the IDG News Service, thanks for watching, and we hope to see you next week.